Antya Lila, Chapter 9. All glories to Sri Krishna Caitanya, the beloved of Goddess Lakshmi. Glories to Lord Caitanya, who is dear to all the Vaishnavas. All glories to the merciful King of Vaikuntha. O Lord, please place your glance of mercy on the conditioned souls. In this way, the Supreme Personality of Godhead joyfully performed kirtan with his devotees. The circle of Vaishnavas knew the foods Lord Caitanya liked since his childhood. With great love, they brought these foods for him. With great love, they cooked these foods and invited the Lord to take his meal. On the day the devotees invited him, the Lord would come and very happily eat. The Vaishnavas' wives were all amsha expansions of Goddess Lakshmi. What were all the wonderful foods they cooked? I do not know. Every mouth was always filled with Lord Krishna's holy names, and every eye was always flooded with tears. The Vaishnavis in Navadvip knew what were Lord Chaitanya's favorite foods. With great love, they cooked these foods, and with great love, Lord Chaitanya ate them. One day, noble-hearted, lion-like Advaita Acarya said to Lord Chaitanya, "Today, please accept your meal at my home. Lord, with my own hand I will cook for you. Please accept a meal from my hand." Lord Chaitanya said, "Anyone who eats the food you cook will attain Lord Krishna. He will attain pure devotion to Lord Krishna. Acarya, your cooking is my very life. What you cook, Lord Krishna eats. I am very inclined to accept a meal you have personally cooked." How did Advaita Acarya float in bliss when he heard Lord Chaitanya's words? I do not know. Happily returning home, Lord Advaita prepared Lord Chaitanya's meal. Advaita's devoted wife, who was an amsha expansion of Goddess Lakshmi, born in this world, happily helped cook. From West Bengal, they had brought many of Lord Chaitanya's favorite foods. When Lord Advaita sat down to cook, Lord Chaitanya entered his heart. Advaita's devoted wife was an expert cook. According to the desire in her heart, she cooked. Thinking shak is the Lord's favorite, she prepared many kinds of shak, 10 different ways. Advaita Acarya cooked and his wife helped. They both floated in an ocean of bliss. In his heart, Lord Advaita thought, "Now I am cooking. Soon the Lord will come. Then I will offer food to the Lord. Then all my desires will be fulfilled." Thinking in this way, in his heart, Lord Advaita cooked. Meanwhile, Lord Chaitanya chanted his fixed number of holy names. Then in his heart, he decided to perform his midday duties. At midday, all the sannyasis came to take their meal with the Lord. At that moment, by Lord Advaita's will, the demigod Indra sent a sudden rainstorm. In the four directions, a hailstorm made a great tumult. There was a fierce windstorm, and the rains had no end. Every direction was covered with blinding darkness. No one had the power to leave his house and walk on the streets. In this way, the great storm fell. No one had the power to stay peaceful. No one knew from where such a storm had come. But where Advaita was cooking, only very little rain fell. None of the sannyasis came to take their meal with Lord Chaitanya. No one could go anywhere. Meanwhile, lion-like Lord Advaita finished cooking. He set out all the preparations of rice and vegetables. He set out many preparations made with ghee, yogurt, milk, condensed milk, and butter. He set out pishtakas, sandesh, katalakas, and many kinds of sweets made with sugar. Over everything he placed tulsi manjaris. He sat down. In meditation, he brought Lord Chaitanya there. As Advaita meditated in his heart, Lord Chaitanya came. By Lord Advaita's desire, Lord Chaitanya in truth came there. Chanting Hare Krishna, Lord Chaitanya lovingly came before Lord Advaita. With great respect, Advaita bowed down before Lord Chaitanya's lotus feet. He offered a seat. Lord Chaitanya sat down. Lord Chaitanya had come alone, without any companions. Seeing this, Advaita became wild with joy. Accompanied by his wife, he happily served Lord Chaitanya. He washed the Lord's feet. He anointed the Lord with sandal paste. He fanned him. Lord Chaitanya sat down and happily ate. Advaita served him. Advaita happily placed many vegetable preparations before the Lord. Tasting the nectar of ecstatic love, Lord Chaitanya accepted them. Lord Chaitanya ate the vegetables. Of each preparation, he left a small part uneaten. Smiling, Advaita said to Lord Chaitanya, "Why did you leave part of the vegetables uneaten? Please let me know the reason." I see that you ate most of the vegetables, only a small part of each preparation you did not eat. Smiling, Lord Chaitanya said, Please listen, O Acarya. Where did you learn how to cook? I have never tasted shock like this. This cooking is all very wonderful. Whatever Advaita Acarya brought, Lord Chaitanya ate everything. Lord Chaitanya is a kalpavriksha tree that fulfills the devotee's desires. Whatever preparations made with yogurt, milk, ghee, and condensed milk Advaita brought, and whatever sandesh sweets he brought, Lord Chaitanya accepted. In this way, Lord Chaitanya, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, ate. He fulfilled all the desires in the heart of lion-like Advaita Acarya. When Lord Chaitanya had finished eating, Advaita Acarya recited Indra's prayers. He said, Today I, Indra, know your great powers. Today I know you are without doubt a great Vaishnav. Today I shower flowers on you. I am Indra. Today you have purchased me. Then Lord Chaitanya said, Why did Indra speak these prayers to me today? Please tell me. Advaita Acarya said, You please eat. Why must I listen to you? Then Lord Chaitanya said, Why do you hide, O Acarya? That sudden rainstorm was all your doing. It was not time for rain. It was so sudden. It was such a great rain. There was hail. By your desire, those calamities came. This I know directly. Therefore I say, when you say these prayers are by Indra, I know what you mean. If he brings many sannyasis, then I will not eat anything. That thought was in your heart. You thought, if the Lord comes alone and eats, then my desire will be fulfilled. That is why you created all those calamities. Staying in their hearts, you forbade the sannyasis to come. What power has Indra to give commands to you? It is Indra's good fortune that he has a chance to serve you. He whose desire Lord Krishna never thwarts, he who has the power to make Lord Krishna directly manifest, he who always obeys Lord Krishna's command, made this rainstorm. What is surprising about that? He whose command Yamaraj, time and death place on their heads, he whose feet the kings of yoga and the kings of the sages yearn to attain, he the memory of whom frees everyone from material bondage, made this rainstorm. What is surprising about that? Who in this world of birth and death knows the truth about you? The person to whom you give your mercy attains the fruit that is pure devotional service. Then Lord Advaita said, You love your servants. With my body, mind, and words, I hold you close to me. I have that power. By the power of devotion to you, I have become a lion that lives forever. I ask this boon. Please never abandon me. When the meal was finished, the two lords joyfully tasted the nectar of this kind of talk. Everything that Lord Advaita said with his graceful mouth was the truth. It was not otherwise. Anyone who is not happy to hear these talks is very lowly and degraded. Lord Advaita certainly remains invisible to him. As they do not understand the talks of Lord Krishna and Lord Shiva, so the materialistic fools do not understand the talks of Lord Chaitanya and Lord Advaita. Anyone who does not like one of these two lords does not like both lords. Lord Chaitanya and Lord Advaita are like Lord Krishna and Lord Shiva. Always speaking words like these, merciful-hearted Lord Advaita delivers the entire world. Please know that anyone who has the power to understand Lord Advaita's words will never be separated from the Supreme Lord. Anyone who devotedly hears these narrations will attain pure devotion to Lord Krishna. Everything will be auspicious for him. Then, having fulfilled the desire in lion-like Advaita Acharya's heart, Lord Chaitanya, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, returned to his home. In this way, accepting meals in the homes of Srivas and the other devotees, Lord Chaitanya fulfilled everyone's desire. Accompanied by his devotees, Lord Chaitanya performed Sankirtan. Moment after moment, he personally danced and made others dance also. Damodar Pandit went to see Mother Sachi. After seeing Mother Sachi, he quickly went to Jagannath Puri. Seeing Damodar Pandit, Lord Chaitanya took him to a private place and asked about Mother Sachi. Lord Chaitanya said, You went to see her? Is my mother devoted to Lord Vishnu? Tell the truth. Hearing these words, renounced and austere Damodar Pandit became angry and said, Master, how can I describe your mother's devotion? Master, why do you ask this question? It is by your mother's mercy that you have devotion to Lord Vishnu. Whatever power you have, all comes from her. Please know without doubt that whatever devotion to Lord Vishnu has arisen within you comes from your mother's mercy. tears, trembling, perspiration, fainting, shouting, and the body's hair standing erect, the symptoms of ecstasy that come from pure devotion to Lord Vishnu, never for a moment stop being manifested on your mother's body. On her graceful mouth is always manifested the holy name of Lord Krishna. Master, you have asked about your mother's devotion. Anyone who asks about her devotion to Lord Vishnu should see your mother. Your mother is devotional service personified. This I tell you. You know this already. Your question is only to bewilder me. Anyone who speaks the ordinary word, i.e., will by the power of the word, no longer suffer any trouble. Hearing his mother's glories from Damodar's mouth, Lord Chaitanya felt bliss that had no limit. Tasting the nectar of ecstatic love, Lord Chaitanya happily embraced Damodar Pandit again and again. Lord Chaitanya said, Damodar, from this day you have the right to sell me. You spoke what was in my heart. Whatever wealth of devotion to Lord Vishnu I possess is all by my mother's mercy. That is not a lie. It is by her desire that I came to this earth. Never will I have the power to repay my debt to her. I am a prisoner in my mother's home. Listen, Damodar, I see my mother at every moment. In this way, Lord Chaitanya gave his mercy to Damodar Pandit. Then Lord Chaitanya returned and sat amongst his devotees. By asking about his mother's devotion, Lord Chaitanya taught a lesson to the entire world. Then Lord Chaitanya asked an old friend about their friends and kinsmen. He said, please tell me about my friends and kinsmen. Do they have an auspicious life? To reveal the fact that devotional service is the true meaning of the word auspicious, Lord Chaitanya asked this question. When devotional service is present, everything is auspicious. When devotional service is absent, even a king has a life that is inauspicious. If a person has all wealth, fame, and pleasures, but no devotional service to the Lord, then everything he has is inauspicious. If a person has not even today's food, and if he lives at the very limit of poverty, but he has devotion to Lord Vishnu, then he is wealthy. On the pretext of accepting invitations for meals, Lord Chaitanya explained this truth to everyone. Smiling, Lord Chaitanya would say to the person inviting him for a meal, O master of 100,000, please come before me. Only the master of 100,000 may invite me to a meal. Hearing this, all the Brahmins became anxious at heart. The Brahmins then offered this prayer, O Lord, who of us has 100,000 coins? None of us have even 1,000 coins. If you will not accept meals from us householders, we will all burn into ashes. Then Lord Chaitanya said, Do you know what the phrase master of 100,000 means? It describes a person who every day chants 100,000 holy names. That person I call master of 100,000. That person may offer me a meal. I will not enter any other house. Hearing the Lord's merciful words, the Brahmins lost their worries and became happy at heart. They said, Lord, we will chant 100,000 holy names. Please accept meals from us. We are fortunate that you have taught this to us. So Lord Chaitanya would accept meals from them. The Brahmins now chanted 100,000 holy names daily. In this way, teaching how to engage in devotional service, the king of Vaikuntha played in an ocean of devotional activities. In this way, Lord Chaitanya taught how to engage in devotional service. The Lord did not ask any question that was not about devotional service. The Lord said, A person who engages in devotional service has an auspicious life. I always stand behind him. Lord Chaitanya would not look at any face that did not glorify devotional service. One day, Lord Chaitanya asked his spiritual master, Keshava Bharati, about bhakti and gyan. Lord Chaitanya said, Which is better, bhakti or gyan? O master, please consider this and tell me your final conclusion. Thinking in his heart for some moments, Keshava Bharati spoke to Lord Chaitanya. Keshava Bharati said, After thinking in my heart, I see that devotional service is more glorious than anything else. Then Lord Chaitanya said, Why is devotional service better than impersonal speculation? The sannyasis say impersonal speculation is better. Keshava Bharati said, They do not know the path the great souls walk. Fools leave the path of the scriptures, the path that great souls walk. Brahma, Shiva, Narada, Prahlad, Sukadev, Vyas, Sanak, and the sages, Yudhisthira, and the Pandavas, Priyavrata, Pratu, Dhruva, Akrura, and Uddhava, are the names of the great souls, the Mahajans. Approaching the Supreme Lord's feet, they all beg for devotional service. Why do they beg for devotional service and not impersonal speculation? Why, without stopping to think, do the great souls turn from impersonal liberation and moment after moment beg for devotional service? All the words of the Puranas prove this. What boon did the demigod Brahma beg from the Supreme Personality of Godhead? Brahma said, "My dear Lord, I pray that I may be so fortunate that in this life or in another life, wherever I may take my birth, I may be counted as one of your devotees. Wherever I may be, I pray that I may be engaged in your devotional service." These words mean, I may take birth as Brahma, or I may take birth in any form of life. I will always be your servant, and I will always serve you. In this way, the great souls turn from everything else and desire only devotional service. In the Vishnu Purana, it is said, O Lord, I may take birth in thousands of wombs, one after another. O infallible Lord, I pray that in each birth, I may have unflinching devotion to you. O Supreme Lord, O Master of the senses, I pray that wherever I take birth, I will always have firm devotion to you. In the Srimad Bhagavatam, it is said, Wherever I wander in the material universe, under the influence of karma, by the will of the Lord, may our auspicious activities cause our attraction to Lord Krishna to increase. In this way, all scriptures declare that devotional service is the best spiritual path, the path of the great souls. In Mahabharata, it is said, Dry arguments are inconclusive. A great personality whose opinion does not differ from others is not considered a great sage. Simply by studying the Vedas, which are variegated, one cannot come to the right path by which religious principles are understood. The solid truth of religious principles is hidden in the heart of an unadulterated, self-realized person. Consequently, as the Shastras confirm, one should accept whatever progressive path the Mahajans advocate. Hearing from Keshava Bharati's mouth the words, devotional service is the best, with joy and love, Lord Chaitanya roared, Hari! Lord Chaitanya said, Now I will stay a few days more on the earth. I tell you the truth. If you had said, impersonal speculation is the best, I would have drowned myself in the ocean. Then Lord Chaitanya happily embraced his guru's feet. With a happy heart, the guru offered obeisances to Lord Chaitanya. Lord Chaitanya said, Anyone whose mouth does not talk about devotion to the Lord wears a sikha and a sacred thread in vain. Lord Chaitanya asked questions only about devotional service and nothing else. Lord Chaitanya was the personified nectar of devotional service. Night and day, the devotees knew nothing but devotional service to the Lord. They always danced and loudly chanted in kirtan. One day, Advaita Acarya, wild with bliss, said to the devotees, Listen, O my brothers, filling our mouths with his names, today we will sing about Lord Chaitanya. Today we will not sing about any other avatar. Lord Chaitanya is the essence of all avatars. Taking us with him, Lord Chaitanya descended to the earth to deliver everyone in all the worlds. By his mercy we are honored everywhere. He has given us the great wealth, that is Sankirtan. I will dance. You all sing Lord Chaitanya's glories. Roar like lions. Leave behind all the fears in your hearts. Lord Chaitanya had hidden himself. All the devotees thought Lord Chaitanya will be angry. However, no one could disobey Advaita Acharya's command. They all sang Lord Chaitanya's glories. Intoxicated with bliss, lion-like Advaita Acharya danced. In the four directions, everyone sang Lord Chaitanya's glories. Hearing the names and glories of Lord Chaitanya, the Lord's most recent avatar in this world, all the Vaishnavas became wild with bliss. Personally singing about Lord Chaitanya, Advaita Acharya danced. In this way, he delivered the worlds. He sang, O Sri Chaitanya, O Narayan, O Ocean of Mercy, O Friend of the Distressed, O Lord, please be merciful to me. When this verse came on lion-like Advaita Acharya's mouth, the kirtan became very glorious. Someone said, Jai Sachinandana. Someone else said, Jai Gaurachandra Narayan. Glory to Chaitanya Narayan. Glory to Chaitanya Krishna, who is fond of Sankirtan. Glory to the Lord, who loves the devotees and is destructive time personified to the blasphemers. Lion-like Advaita Acharya wildly danced. All the devotees sang of Lord Chaitanya's names, virtues, and activities. They sang a song in Sri Raga. Look at Lord Chaitanya. As he joyfully sings the Supreme Lord's glories, he rolls about on the ground, and the hairs of his body stand erect. He is Lord Krishna himself. He is the king of Vaikuntha. Assuming the form of a Brahmin, he has descended to this world. now he enjoys pastimes of Sankirtan. His graceful body splendor defeats gold. His arms reach to his knees. Assuming the form of a sannyasi, he has become wild by tasting the nectar of love for a person who is actually himself. Why does he dance so blissfully? I do not know. Glory to Lord Chaitanya, who is handsome and fair, and who is an ocean of mercy. Glory, glory to the King of Vrindavan. Glories to he who is now the King of Navadweep. O Lord, please give me the shade of your lotus feet. All the devotees sang kirtan. Meditating on Lord Chaitanya's feet, Advaita Acarya danced. Hearing these new verses about the Lord's most recent avatar, the Vaishnavas joyfully sang the names of Lord Krishna. How wonderful was the bliss in that kirtan. Lord Nityananda alone has the power to describe it completely. Hearing the loud sounds of the kirtan, Lord Chaitanya, the jewel of the sannyasis, came there. Seeing Lord Chaitanya, the devotees sang with even more joy, and Advaita Acarya danced with even more bliss. Filled with bliss, no one feared Lord Chaitanya. Everyone openly sang of Lord Chaitanya's glories. In his pastimes, Lord Chaitanya was always in the mood of Lord Krishna's servant. He would say, "I am a servant of Lord Krishna. Please do not call me anything else." No one had the power to face him and openly call him the Supreme Personality of Godhead. They could only call him Lord Krishna's servant. Still, by Advaita Acharya's power, they were now fearlessly singing songs declaring that Lord Chaitanya was Lord Krishna himself. Lord Chaitanya, the jewel of the sannyasis, stood for a moment and listened to the songs glorifying him. Then he became embarrassed and fled. To teach everyone, Lord Chaitanya, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the Supreme Siksha Guru, went home when he heard others singing a kirtan glorifying him. Even so, fear was not born in any heart. Now they sang Lord Chaitanya's glories all the more. External consciousness was not present in anyone's body. Everyone saw that Lord Chaitanya was present in the kirtan glorifying him. Everyone wildly sang Lord Chaitanya's glories. They became almost like madmen. The saintly devotees heard that kirtan with joy. The wicked were unhappy to hear it. Of what value are brahmacharya or sannyas to a person who is not pleased by Lord Chaitanya's glories? In this way, the devotees always joyfully sang Sankirtan of Lord Krishna's holy names. Anyone who reads or hears of all these blissful pastimes will one day meet all the personal associates of Lord Chaitanya. Singing and dancing, all these great devotees went to see Lord Chaitanya. Hearing the kirtan glorifying him and then seeing how everyone had come, Lord Chaitanya became afraid. He lay down to go to sleep. Saintly Govinda informed the Lord, "All the Vaishnavas are at your door." Lord Chaitanya ordered Govinda to bring them all inside. Then Lord Chaitanya went to sleep. No one looked in any other direction. They looked only at him. Afraid, all the devotees meditated on Lord Chaitanya's feet. In a moment, Lord Chaitanya, who dearly loves his devotees, awakened. He said, "Ah, all the Vaishnavas. Ah, saintly Srivas Pandit, why have you all come here today? Why, abandoning Lord Krishna's holy names and abandoning kirtan glorifying Lord Krishna, have you all come and awakened me?" Very eloquent Srivas said, "Lord, the individual souls have no power to act independently against your will. As the Supreme Personality of Godhead makes me act and speak, so I act and speak. This I tell you." Lord Chaitanya said, "You are all pundits. Why do you hide your knowledge?" Hearing Lord Chaitanya's words, Srivas Pandit moved his hand as if he were trying to cover the sun. Then he laughed. Lord Chaitanya said, "What do you hint by moving your hand like that? Tell me what your gesture means." Srivas said, "With this hand, I will cover the sun. Thus, I tell you the meaning of this gesture. Do I have the power to cover the sun with one hand? In the same way, you have no power to hide yourself. Even if someday I get the power to cover the sun with my hand, you will still have no power to hide yourself. On the ocean of milk, you could not hide yourself. How will you hide yourself in the world of human beings? Your pure glories will fill every direction, from the Himalayas to Setubandhu to the entire earth. The kirtan glorifying you will fill the entire universe, reaching up to Brahmaloka. How many people will sing in that kirtan? How will you punish them all?" The Supreme Personality of Godhead always chants the glories of his devotees. Now a great wonder had come to the Lord's own door. From where did so many thousands and thousands of people come? I do not know. After seeing Lord Jagannath, they all went to see Lord Chaitanya. Some had come from Tripura, others from Chattigram, others from Srihat, and others from East Bengal. Thousands and thousands of people sang a kirtan glorifying Lord Chaitanya. They sang, Glory, glory to Sri Krishna Chaitanya, who is forest flower garlanded Lord Krishna. Glory, glory to the Lord, who now happily tastes the nectar of devotional service to a person who is actually himself. Glories to the Lord, who has now assumed the form of the supreme sannyasi. All glories to Lord Krishna, who is now eager to enjoy pastimes of Sankirtan. Glories, glories to the King of Brahmins, who is actually the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the Master who enjoys pastimes in Vaikuntha. Glories, glories to the Lord who blesses all the worlds. Glories to Sachi's son, Sri Krishna Chaitanya. In this way, everyone sang while 100 persons danced. Then Srivas said, Lord, what will you do? The whole world is singing. Where will you hide? Lord, what should I teach the whole world? Lord, the whole world is singing like this. Lord, you do not appear before the conditioned souls. They cannot see you, but because you are merciful, you now stand before their eyes. You hide from them, and also you reveal yourself to them. They who attain your mercy understand you. Lord Chaitanya said, by your own power you arranged all this. With your own mouth you told everyone in the world, this I know. I am defeated by you. Listen, O Pundit, I know you have all powers. The Supreme Personality of Godhead always praises his devotees. That is his nature. This the Vedas and the Srimad Bhagavatam say. With a smiling face, Lord Chaitanya bid farewell to all the Vaishnavas. They all returned to their homes. Lord Chaitanya loves his devotees. Because of him, everyone chants Krishna. Lord Nityananda, Lord Advaita, and all the other personal associates of the Lord affirm, Sri Krishna Chaitanya is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. They who disagree with the Supreme Lord's words and say that Lord Chaitanya is not Lord Krishna are unfortunate. Lord Krishna rests on Ananta Shesh, bears the mark of Srivats, is decorated by the Kastoba jewel, and is carried by Garuda. Also, the Ganga is not born from any place but his lotus feet. Please know without doubt that the presence of these indicates that a person is Lord Krishna. Except for Lord Chaitanya, no one else in this age manifested these symptoms of Lord Krishna. This the Vedas, the other scriptures, and the Vaishnavas all declare. They who honor these words of the Vaishnavas become victorious and glorious everywhere. In these ways, Lord Chaitanya always enjoyed pastimes with his devotees. Like the moon illuminating the four directions, Lord Chaitanya was surrounded by his devotees. In the midst of that circle of devotees, Lord Chaitanya, who is the jewel of the sannyasis and the king of Vaikuntha, always talked about Lord Krishna and chanted Lord Krishna's names. At that time, two very fortunate persons approached Lord Chaitanya. Lord Chaitanya cast his merciful glance on those two brothers, one of whom bore the name Sakar Malik. From afar, they offered dandavat obeisances, blades of grass between their teeth, in voices breaking with emotion. They said, glories, glories to Sri Krishna Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, by whose mercy the whole world has become fortunate. Glories to the friend of the fallen, the benefactor of the whole world. Glory, glory to the Lord, who now has the form of the most exalted sannyasi. Glories to the Lord, who enjoys pastimes of Sankirtan without end. Glories to the Supreme Lord, who is the beginning, middle, and end of everything. O Lord, assuming the form of a Vaishnav, you descended to this world. Giving it the gift of pure devotional service, you delivered the entire world. But Lord, why did you not deliver us too? Are we not also in this world? From birth, we were bewildered by sense pleasure. We did not know that your feet were our only true welfare. We did not associate with your devotees. We did not sing or hear your kirtan. Making us ministers of the king, you cheated us. Why did you give us that kind of birth in the world of human beings? We took birth among human beings, a birth even the demigods desire. O Lord, but then, after giving us that birth, you cheated us. Lord, please do not cheat us. Give us your mercy. We chant your names. We offer dandavat obeisances to you. We stand at your door. We beg for the remnants of mercy left by the dear devotees who take shelter of you. In this way, the two brothers, Rupa and Sanatan, offered prayers. Lord Chaitanya listened. Placing his glance of mercy on them, Lord Chaitanya mercifully spoke. The Lord said, you are both very fortunate. Breaking the bonds of material life, you left your homes. The whole world is bound by sense pleasures. You too escape those bonds. If you wish to attain devotional service and spiritual love, then fall down before Advaita Acarya and grasp his feet. Saintly Advaita Acarya is the treasure house of the most valuable pure devotion. By Advaita Acarya's mercy, you will attain pure devotion to Lord Krishna. Hearing Lord Chaitanya's command, the two great souls offered dandavat obeisances to Lord Advaita's feet. They said, glories to Sri Advaita, the purifier of the fallen. O Lord, please deliver us, two fallen souls. Lord Chaitanya said, listen. Listen, O Lord Advaita Acarya. In the Kali Yuga, no person is renounced like these two. They renounced kingly pleasures. With only two water pots and some patchwork clothing, they stayed in Mathura and chanted Lord Krishna's holy names. Please don't cheat them. Give them both pure devotion to Lord Krishna. Birth after birth, they never forget Lord Krishna. You are the treasure house of pure devotional service. If you do not give the gift of pure devotional service, how will Lord Krishna, his devotees, and their pure devotional service meet together? Then Advaita Acarya said, Lord, you are the giver of everything. If you order me to give, then I will give. Lord, if you order, then I can give the whole treasury to whomever you give your mercy. With my body, heart, and words, I say, may these two attain perfect pure devotional service and ecstatic spiritual love. Hearing Advaita Acarya's merciful words, everyone made a great sound of Lord Hari's holy names. Then Lord Chaitanya said to Dabirkas, now you will perfect pure devotional service and ecstatic spiritual love. By Lord Advaita's mercy, you will attain pure devotion to Lord Krishna. Please know that Lord Advaita has all the powers of Lord Krishna. After some days spent gazing at Lord Jagannath's graceful face, you two brothers, please go to Mathura, leaving passion and ignorance far behind. Go to the West and give everyone the nectar of pure devotional service. Going to Mathura Mandal, I will see you again. Please prepare a secluded place for me to stay. Abandoning his former name, Sakra Malik accepted the name Sanatan Goswami. Even today, those two brothers, Rupa Goswami and Sanatan Goswami, are famous as the abodes of Lord Chaitanya's mercy. Lord Chaitanya spreads the fame of his devotees in their devotional service. He preaches the truth about Lord Nityananda and Lord Advaita. He glorifies his very dear devotees. Lord Chaitanya happily revealed their glories. Lord Chaitanya happily revealed everything about his devotees, their identity, how they descended to this world, how they took birth as Amsha incarnations of liberated Vaishnavas and Vaishnavis, their glories, and how they worship and serve the Lord. One day, with Advaita, Srivas, and the other devotees around him in the four directions, Lord Chaitanya revealed these truths. At that time, Srivas Pandit asked Lord Chaitanya to speak about Advaita Acarya. Lord Chaitanya said, Srivas, you tell me, what great Vaishnav dwells in Advaita Acarya? Thinking in his heart, saintly Srivas said, my heart thinks Advaita Acarya is like Sukadev or like Prahlad. Hearing that Advaita Acarya was like Sukadev or like Prahlad, Lord Chaitanya angrily struck Srivas. Like a father lovingly training his son, Lord Chaitanya hit Srivas. Lord Chaitanya said, what did you say? What did you say, Srivas Pandit? You said my Nara is Sukadev or Prahlad? If you say he is Sukadev, then tomorrow all the children will say Nara is Sukadev. Srivas, by saying this about my Nara, you make me very unhappy. After speaking these words, Lord Chaitanya angrily took in his hand a stick to beat Srivas and drive him away. At once, standing up, saintly Advaita humbly grabbed Lord Chaitanya's hand. Lord Advaita said, when he trains his son, a father has mercy in his heart. Who in the three worlds is the object of your anger? Hearing Advaita Acharya's words, Lord Chaitanya threw his anger far away. In ecstasy, he described Lord Advaita's glories. Lord Chaitanya said, whom you accept as your son, I also accept as my son. That is why I now throw my anger far away. To teach the people, Nara broke my sleep and brought me here. Lord Chaitanya continued, O saintly Srivas, you should be very meek and humble before my Nara. Sukadev and all the sages are Nara's sons. Please know they all took birth after Nara. It is because of Advaita Acarya that I descended to this world. Nara's loud calls entered my ear. I peacefully slept on the milk ocean. Then Nara's loud calls wakened me and brought me here. Hearing Lord Chaitanya's very affectionate words describing Advaita Acarya, Srivas became very pleased. Trembling with fear, Srivas said, I committed an offense. O Lord, please forgive me. You alone know the truth about your Advaita Acarya. Now that you teach us, your servants also may know it. Today, I have become very fortunate. Today, everything is auspicious, for you have taught this to me. Your explanation of Advaita's exalted position increases the honor I feel for him in my heart. From today on, I make this vow. Even if he drinks wine, or even if he embraces an outcast woman, I will always have great devotion to Advaita Acarya. Lord, these words I say to you are the sincere truth. Lord Chaitanya was pleased with Srivas's words. Then the three of them happily sat down as before. Anyone who hears this very secret and sacred narration will attain Lord Krishna. Lord Chaitanya has all power and all devotion. His power begins and ends everything. He knows everything. A person who knows this sincerely worships Lord Chaitanya. A person who cannot understand these words of Lord Chaitanya describing the truth of Lord Vishnu cannot understand the truth of the great Vaishnavas either. Persons who, not understanding a perfect Vaishnava's sometimes harsh actions, criticize that Vaishnava, and they suffer in the world of birth and death. Therefore, please see the harsh actions of a perfect Vaishnava to be like his most eloquent words of teaching. Bhrigu Muni, who was the foremost of Vaishnavas, who was Brahma's son, and who day and night meditated on the Supreme Lord's lotus feet, kicked the Supreme Lord's chest. Even so, please see him as the best of Vaishnavas. Please hear Srimad Bhagavatam's account of how Bhrigu Muni fulfilled his desire. In ancient times, many great sages met on the bank of the Saraswati to perform great yajnas and hear the Puranas. They were all authors of shastras. They all possessed a great wealth of austerity. They met to discuss the identity of the Supreme. That assembly of sages considered the question of Brahma, Vishnu, and Shiva, who is the best? Some sages said, Brahma is the best. Others said, Shiva is the best. Still others said, Vishnu is the best of all. The Puranas all had different opinions. In some places, Puranas said, Shiva is the best. In other places, they said, Narayan is the best. The assembled sages sent Bhrigu Muni to learn the truth. They said to him, O saintly mind-born son of Brahma, you are the eldest, the best, and the wisest of us all. Please, go and find an answer to our question. Please break apart our doubt. Whatever you say, we accept as the truth. Hearing these words, Bhrigu went first to visit the demigod Brahma. Arriving in Brahma's assembly, Bhrigu Muni acted very arrogantly before Brahma. Seeing his son, Brahma became very happy. He asked about his son's welfare. Then Bhrigu, who was Brahma's son, tested his father. He did not treat his father's words with respect. He did not offer prayers, act in a humble way, or bow down before his father. Seeing that his son was not respectful, Brahma became angry. He was like fire personified. His heart filled with anger. He was about to burn his son to ashes. Seeing his father's form in this way, Bhrigu fled. Everyone else there grasped Brahma's feet and begged, Lord, why are you so angry with your own son? Filled with love for his son, Brahma forgot his anger. He was like a fire extinguished by water. Now understanding the true nature of Brahma, Bhrigu went to Mount Kailas to test Shiva. Seeing Bhrigu, Shiva was delighted. Accompanied by Parvati, he offered respectful greetings. With the respect of an elder brother, Shiva stood to lovingly embrace Bhrigu. Bhrigu said, Shiva, don't touch me. You embrace the blasphemers. The Bhutas, Pretas, and Pisachas are all untouchables. You give shelter to all those offenders. You have strayed from the right path. In what scripture is the rule that one should wear bones and smear one's body with ashes? If I touch you, I will have to bathe. Go away, O king of the ghosts. Bhrigu spoke these words only as a test. True blasphemy of Lord Shiva never touched Bhrigu's saintly mouth. Hearing Bhrigu's words, Shiva angrily picked up his trident. Forgetting that he was Bhrigu's elder brother, Shiva became like death personified. Shiva picked up his trident to kill Bhrigu. Goddess Parvati at once grasped Shiva's hand. Grasping Shiva's feet, Goddess Parvati said, Lord, you are his elder. Why are you so angry with your brother? Embarrassed by the goddess's words, Shiva stopped. Then Bhrigu went to Vaikuntha, the abode of Lord Krishna. At that moment, the Supreme Lord reclined on a jewel couch as Goddess Lakshmi served his graceful feet. At that moment, Bhrigu suddenly came and kicked the Supreme Lord's chest. Seeing Bhrigu, the Supreme Lord at once rose. Cheerfully, affectionately, and respectfully, he bowed down before Bhrigu Muni. Accompanied by Goddess Lakshmi, the Supreme Lord then happily washed Bhrigu's feet. Then the Lord offered Bhrigu a sitting place on an opulent throne. With his own hand, the Supreme Lord anointed Bhrigu's limbs with sandal paste. Although Bhrigu had acted like an offender, the Supreme Lord begged forgiveness for what he thought was his own offense. The Supreme Lord said, I did not know you were coming. Therefore I offended you. Please forgive me. The sacred water that has washed your feet makes the pilgrimage places holy. By now giving me the water from your feet, you have purified all the universes and demigods who stay in my body. These are your actions. I am very happy that I now have your dust footprint on my chest. Now I have a proper place for Goddess Lakshmi to stay on my chest. The Vedas will call your footprint on my chest by the name Srivats. Hearing the Supreme Lord's humble words and seeing that the Lord was completely beyond all lust, anger, greed, and illusion, the great sage Bhrigu became filled with wonder. Embarrassed, he did not lift his head. Bhrigu's actions were not ordinary. Please know without doubt that his actions were inspired by ecstatic devotion. With love and faith, Bhrigu gazed and gazed at the Supreme Lord. Filled with the nectar of pure devotion, he began to dance. He laughed, trembled, perspired, fainted, and roared. The hairs of his body stood erect. Brahma's son, Bhrigu, was plunged in the nectar of pure devotion. He said, Krishna is the Lord of all. He is the life of all. Speaking these truths, Bhrigu Muni danced. Seeing Lord Krishna's peacefulness and humbleness, who would not attain ecstatic love and devotion for him? Bhrigu Muni was stunned with ecstatic devotion. No words came to his mouth. A stream of joyful tears flowed from his eyes. On his body were all the symptoms of ecstatic love for Lord Krishna. Bhrigu Muni finally returned to the assembly of sages. Seeing Bhrigu, the sages became joyful without limit. They said, Bhrigu, tell us, whom did you see? What did they do? Tell us, who is the best? Then Bhrigu spoke to them. To all of them, Bhrigu described the actions of Brahma, Shiva, and Vishnu. He said, Lord Narayan, the king of Vaikuntha, is the best of all. That is the truth. This I tell you. Lord Krishna is the master of everyone. He is the father of everyone. Brahma and Shiva obtain their authority from him. Lord Narayan is the creator, maintainer, and destroyer of all. Therefore, without doubting, please worship his feet. Religion, knowledge, good reputation, opulence, and renunciation all come from his potencies. Everything belongs to Lord Krishna. Please know this without doubt. Therefore, please worship Lord Krishna and sing his glories. Lord Chaitanya is Lord Krishna himself, Krishna who now enjoys pastimes of Sankirtan. Hearing Bhrigu's words, the sages became free of all doubts. They agreed, Narayan is the best of all. The sages worshiped Bhrigu Muni. They said, you cut our doubts into pieces. You made our hearts auspicious and pure. They made their hearts firm in devotion to Lord Krishna. Thinking them true devotees of Lord Krishna, they honored Brahma and Shiva. Therefore I say, who has the power to understand the sometimes harsh actions of perfect Vaishnavas? Bhrigu Muni's actions were only a test. They were not anything but that. That is why he kicked the Lord. Why was the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the creator of the worlds, merciful even after Bhrigu Muni kicked his chest? The actions of very elevated persons cannot be understood or copied by ordinary persons. That is the only conclusion. I see no other. The root of all this is that Lord Krishna himself entered the body of Bhrigu Muni and arranged all these activities to reveal the great glory of devotional service. Bhrigu himself did not know in advance what was to happen. By arranging these actions, Lord Krishna revealed the glory of both himself and his devotees. In order to reveal the glory of Lord Krishna, Brahma and Shiva became angry with Bhrigu and made him afraid. Thus the devotees always sing Lord Krishna's glories, and Lord Krishna even more earnestly praises his devotees' glories. Anyone who, not understanding his actions, criticizes an elevated Vaishnav will not be delivered. An elevated Vaishnav sometimes acts in a way superficially like the actions of lowly people. Anyone who, by Lord Krishna's mercy, has the power to understand an elevated Vaishnav's actions will end all his troubles. He will become delivered. In this situation, I see only one way a person can save himself from danger. One should humbly glorify every Vaishnav. A person who does not understand all this should take shelter of Lord Krishna and carefully hear the explanations of great devotees. Then Lord Krishna will give him spiritual intelligence. He will attain Lord Krishna. Nothing will stop him. Anyone who devotedly hears these pastimes of Lord Chaitanya will easily attain liberation. Sri Krishna Chaitanya and Lord Nityananda Prabhu are my life and soul. I, Vrindavan Das, humbly offer this song at their lotus feet.